knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We just spent a significant amount of time discussing the clade Spiralia. Now it's time to examine Ecdysozoa, which is the sister clade to the Spiralians. The term Ecdysozoa is rooted in the Greek word ekdousis, meaning shedding, and zoion, meaning animal. Therefore, they are the shedding animals. Specifically, they all go through ekdysis in order to grow. Ecdysis involves the molting of the chitinous cuticle, often referred to as the exoskeleton in arthropods and some other groups. In some members of Ecdysozoa, the cuticle is prominent and forms formidable armor, like in many crustaceans. In others, like the nematodes, the cuticle is much less obvious. Due to the presence of the cuticle and the fact that its molting allows for molts to outnumber carcasses, that is, the molt left behind after ecdysis is still every bit as tough as the new cuticle that grows and hardens, many ecdysozoans, most notably the arthropods, have an extraordinarily rich fossil record. The clade itself was first proposed in 1992 based on phylogenetic analyses, but it was formally named in 1997 due to analyses of rRNA sequences. Originally, it contained all members of Panarthropoda, which includes phyla Arthropoda, Onychophora, and Tardigrada. Nematoida, or phyla Nematoda and Nematomorpha. And Scelidophora, which is phyla Cynorhynchia and Priapulida. Loricifera was added later. Since then, a great deal of studies have confirmed the monophyly of Ecdysozoa, including major studies in 2008, 2015, and 2021. However, there are still some ongoing arguments regarding the evolutionary relationships within the clade. For example, a 2015 study placed Loricifera as close relatives to Panarthropoda, but a 2022 study concluded they are more closely related to Scelidophora. That's actually why it's placed near the outside of the Ecdysozoan group. We're not really sure yet where it belongs. At the moment, it's placed on even footing with the other members of Scelidophora, but that might change. However, its placement within Ecdysozoa is considered sound. Though ecdysis is often considered the defining characteristic of the clade, their most notable characteristic is likely the simple presence of their 3- or 4-layered chitinous cuticle. They also lack cilia for locomotion, and unlike many phyla of their sister clade, Spiralia, they do not undergo spiral cleavage in development. Also, most produce amoeboid sperm instead of flagellated sperm. In addition to these characteristics, members of Ecdysozoa as well as Spiralia are considered to be protostomes, meaning that during development the first embryonic opening becomes the mouth, as opposed to the deuterostomes, where the first embryonic opening becomes the anus. Thus, all protostomes are first mouth animals due to their embryonic development. Note that the protostomes are split into the two sister clades of Spiralia and Ecdysozoa. Going back a bit further, all Ecdysozoans are members of Nephrozoa and Bilateria. All members possess three unique germ layers, which are ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm, and they are either coelomates or pseudocoelomates. Some members, like the arthropods, are segmented, while others, like the nematodes, are unsegmented. Some members are colonial and others solitary. Regardless, all Ecdysozoans are protostomes with a layered cuticle that is shed during ecdysis and do not undergo spiral cleavage during development. Ecdysozoa contains the majority of animal life on our planet. This clade possesses more diversity than every other animal phylum combined, and they have colonized nearly every habitat on the planet, including the deep seas, hydrothermal vents, and polar ice caps. Some Ecdysozoans have been found surviving over 2.2 miles deep in the Earth's crust, and others can even survive in outer space. We will be going over them all in great detail, but let's start first with the three smallest Ecdysozoan phyla, beginning with Loricifera.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.